From the Remnant Bible School Church, amen. We got callers calling in from New York, calling in from representing Mexico. Who's that? Amen. I think we got another one from California. Coming out of the Rasta hairstyle, dreadlocks. Why is it so popular now? Everybody's wearing dreadlocks. What's going on? We have a caller with a question today, ladies and gentlemen. I believe that Mexico's got another question about something else. In the name of the Most High God, greetings in the name of Jesus, our soon coming King. Bless the Lord. That was the great Bob Marley, and I'm sure that even the cockroach in the most remote part of the earth has heard his sound. Amen. Well known man, another wearer of the dreadlocks. We're gonna go into it today. We've got a caller on the line right now, I believe, from New York. Bless the Lord. And from Mexico. Let's hear your questions.
Yes, please.
Shalom.
We just follow you, and we would like to know the representation of Rasta anywhere in the Bible.
All right. You're saying you want to see some kind of representation of the Rasta in the Bible.
It's important, you know, the black or so all the time.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And do they have any importance? Mm-hmm. Not even relevant.
What is the significance? If Rasta is here, what is their purpose?
If the Rastas are there, what is their purpose? Yes. These are good questions. Right. Mexico, we have a question. Line 2. Shalom.
Hi.
¿Cómo estás? What is it? ¿Cómo estás?
Hola.
Hola, Mexico.
Hola.
Bless the Lord. What's your question, madam?
I did have a question. I wanted to know, because I've been reading all over the Bible, and I just wanted to know, what is this vow that I keep hearing about?
Where is this vow that you keep hearing about?
Yes,
what
ma'am.
Is this vow you keep hearing about? All right. Number 2 question. We have a caller from California who has a question. Go ahead, caller from California. Let's have you.
Amen.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom. I'm calling regarding, do the nations have any presence in the Bible?
Well, I mean, they've got a presence.
Right, but what are the nations? Do the nations have anywhere?
Do they have a spot?
To in the afterlife?
Oh, so you want to know if the nations have got a spot?
Yes, ma'am.
Hmm. All right. Let's find out if you've still got that same spot I thought you had. Bless the Lord. We're going to start answering these questions, ladies and gentlemen, one by one. Bless the Lord. That's three beautiful questions, amen, coming in from all around. Amen. Making sure we have no more questions. Bless the Lord. Amen. We're going to do a little background. So Ethiopia, which is cited right there in Genesis 2 and 13, from in the beginning and all the way through the Bible to the very end. Amen. They accepted Christianity after being a Judaic nation long before Christ. We're going back to the question of the first caller about, is there any presence, is there even any relevance of the Rasta community in the Bible? The destruction of Jerusalem in 588 BC was the beginning of the dispersion of that particular group of Israelites. Amen. And the Jews constructed an independent state in Ethiopia after being rejected everywhere else. Now, those people who are the Rastas of that particular quadrant of people, they have their own Bible. It's called the Holy Pipi, or the Black Man's Bible, written by, I believe, Robert A. Rogers. Amen. You can look it up and take a look. You know, we're just here to help you think a little bit. The main doctrines are Jah, cannabis, dreadlocks, idol food, Leoric, Lion of Judah, and Levite. Their central figures, Eli, Selassie, Jesus, Menem, Afsor, Marcus Garvey. Key scriptures, the Bible, the Kibra, the Nagast, My Life and Ethiopian Progress, and the Promise Key of the Holy Royal Parchment Scroll of Black Supremacy. Amen. My understanding is that their festivals consist of the Shashani and the Ground Nation Day and Reasoning Day. And again, their notable individuals are Leonard Harwell, Joseph Hilbert, Archibald Dunkley, Marty Moore, Plano, Vernon Carrington, and Charles Edwards, and of course, Bob Marley. Don't leave him out. And in their society, they had the relation of Judaism. They suffered a lot of persecution, especially when they were moved, a portion of them, to the United States of America. Theology outlined the work of the Rastaman by his presence in Acts chapter 13 and verse 1. This is the caller number one from the New York City, where it reads, now there were in the church that was in Antioch certain prophets and teachers, as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called Niger, the Lucius, and Cyrene, and Manne, which had been brought up with Herod to Tetrarch and Saul. Amen. Bless the Lord. Now, in the Amplified version of the Bible, it reads, amen, and teachers as Barnabas and Simeon, that was called the Black Man. And in this one, it says, Niger, the Lucius of Cyrene, bless the Lord. So we do have a presence of the Black Man in the Bible right there as a follower of Jesus Christ. We bless the Lord. Amen. Am I answering your questions, young man, or not?
Yeah.
In Revelation 21 and 14 is going to tell us where they are in the last part, in the last days, when it's all over. In Revelation 21 and verse 14, it says, "And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and in them were the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb." So the 12 apostles that were black men were on the boat working for Jesus after he had left to spread the gospel, to spread the news of and the message of Jesus Christ. The names of these men, all of them, whether they had locks or not, they are going to be the 12 foundations, and in those 12 foundations, the names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. So do they have a significance? Yes, they do. Do they have a significance even in the last days? Yes, they do. They're going to be currently everywhere, and they are everywhere. Amen. No, amen, amen.
Amen, amen. Amen.
I'm going to go then to Acts chapter 18 and verse 18, where it reads here, "And Paul, after is tarried there yet a good while, he took his leave of the brethren, and he sailed into Syria with them, Priscilla and Aquila, having shorn his head in Cenchrea, for he had a vow, and the vow that he had was a Nazarite vow." Bless the Lord. This is what these men had their hair. So let's see where this Nazarite vow comes from. And we go to the book of Numbers. Amen. And it will tell us where the vow came from.
Amen.
Amen. Numbers chapter 6. If anybody's there before me, you are welcome to read. Bless the Lord. But I'm going to go there. In the name of Jesus. "And the Lord spoke to Moses, and he said, Speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, When either man or woman shall separate themselves to vow a vow of a Nazarite, to separate themselves unto the Lord, he shall separate himself also from wine, strong drink, vinegar, and liquor, dried grapes. And it says that all the days of the vow," verse 5, "of his separation, there shall no razor come to his head until the days be fulfilled, in which he separates himself unto the Lord. He shall be holy, and shall let the locks of his hair, of his head, grow." And we know that Solomon had very long locks, and they were thick, and there was only 7 of them, so they were big and thick. We know about his ones. We're going to turn it up all over the place here. We got Acts chapter 3 and verse 19. Amen. I'm going to go back again. Bless the Lord. Amen. 3 and 19, praise God. It says, "Repent therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the time of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord." So you see, that's their mark that they have repented. That's their mark that they are with God. Okay, amen, bless the Lord. And then 13 and 13, bless the Lord. Says, I got the wrong one on that one. It was a different one. It was a different one, I remember. I believe it was this one, the same one from Acts chapter 13 and verse 1, where it was describing that the men, oh my goodness, that they were indeed black men. I mean, you know, they want to move like there's no black presence in the Bible. Amen. We see here where Paul, he had locks because it said that he cut them off. Paul, after he had tarried there yet a while, he took his leave of the brethren, sailed thence, amen, with Priscilla and Aquila, having shorn his head in Cenchrea, for he had a vow. So Paul was a Rasta as well. Okay, this is getting juicy. And the other part of the question, when you asked me, well, do they have a significance? Yes, they do, because they are going to be on the very foundation of the city where only the saved will walk. Amen?
Amen. Wow.
And we'll find that argument in Revelation chapter 21 and verse 24, when the sister said, what about the nations? Do they have a spot? Do we have a spot? Because she's Korean. It says, and the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it. And the kings of the earth do bring their glory unto it. So yes, the nations do have a spot. A great spot. I mean, they're going to be walking right in there, according to what this says. Amen. Then we had the question from Mexico. She wanted to know, well, what is this vow? Why is there got to be a vow? Well, you're going to find that most roads that lead to the Most High, they carry some kind of vow. Let's get some examples. You've got the Catholic Church. They got a vow of repentance and penance. Repentance is the core of their religion. Bless the Lord. Islam, they are in a vow of submission. You see, with Islam, it's a submission is the key. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he submitted like no other. Amen. The vows of the Nazarite is a vow of abstinence. Abstinence from what? What is this vow? Well, it's abstinence from sin, period. You've sold out. You're not going to be bothered with anything. No wine, nothing to make wine, no pork, no ham, no pepperoni, no bacon, none of that stuff. You're going to cover up. Yes. And you're going to grow your hair as a mark, just like how the Catholic have their mark, confession and penance. The Muslims have their mark, submission. The Nazarites also have their mark, abstinence of everything. That sounds like Paul, doesn't it? That really does sound like the message of Paul. Abstinence. Paul didn't even want to marry. And he also said, I wish that you would never get married too. But if you can't hold yourself, it's better to marry than to burn. Now the rabbis are under the law. And their mark is in the faithfulness of God, the expectation of the faithfulness of the Most High, and their faithfulness to the law. And justice. They believe in that. They believe in that. They believe in that. They believe in that. The Messianic Jews are under the new covenant, under the rebirth through Jesus Christ, the Nazarene. Nazarene. He was also under a Nazarite vow, so he had locks as well. Amen. So it makes sense now, bless the Lord, that his followers, amen. The book of Acts also tells us, I can't find that scripture right now. We have another one here. Acts 24 verse 18 and Acts 21 verse 27, that there were Jews that came from Asia. So yes, the nations do have a spot. We had Jews that were coming out of Asia. I'll repeat, Acts 24 verse 18 and Acts 21 verse 27 will tell you that. And Psalms 33 verse 12 says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Yes, yes. Well, do they have a relevance? We don't understand it. Why is it that they call him Jah? Well, let's see. Why do they call him Jah? We'll go to Psalms, I believe, 69 and find out that real quick. Amen. Find out why they're calling him Jah. Well, we don't know why everybody else don't call him Jah. We only know that Psalm 69 and verse 4 says, sing unto God. That's what Bob Marley did. Sing praises to his name. That's what Bob Marley did. Extol him that rides upon the heavens by his name, Jah, and rejoice before him. Right here, I'm going to pull it up because there are those who say, oh, that's her Bible, King James Version. Right here, J-A-H, Jah. There it is. So now you know why they call him Jah. Now you know why those that follow Jah, they abstain from all things. They under a Nazarite vow where they cannot have strong drink, where they cannot have liquor, where they cannot fornicate. They cannot do anything in the way of sin. And the vow on the head is supposed to be a mark of that. And I want to say that was Psalm 68 verse 4 that said his name is Jah. That's Psalm 68 verse 4. Amen. Bless the Lord. I want to thank all the callers, amen, today for their contribution. Bless the Lord to these mighty questions. And I appreciate all your questions. And I enjoy answering all your questions, and I do my best. And I'm not saying that what I'm giving you is the entire doctrine of Rastafarianism. No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying that this is what I have researched and are answering your question with. Amen, in the name of Jesus. So today, God bless you all. God keep you and cause his light to ever shine upon you and give you peace. Shabbat shalom.